We're good. We're on.
Wednesday night, the prayer
devotional, the prayer study started Wednesday, 11 o'clock. If you would like to be in the audience, downstairs in the fellowship hall, you can be here while Pastor Keith teaches live. Otherwise, it will be available on the website, the app, Facebook Live, and you can watch it at any time you'd like. If you want a book, contact the church office, and we're going to work through the book. It's two chapters a week. Each chapter is only 10 or 15 minutes, so it's pretty light lifting, but really important material. And this is one of those things that, again, in the spirit of unity, we want to make sure we're all doing this. We want everyone to understand the same language and be doing the same study when it comes to prayer. There's a possibility of the Holy Land trip for those that show some interest in that. Maybe next year there's a revival, some conversation around making a trip to the Holy Land. I have to say, Pastor Keith, for somebody who's in marketing, I don't understand this announcement. Possibility of a Holy Land trip next year. Less days, more money. I don't know if that's selling it very well. But
that is not what the note said.
It says less games, more money. if you'd like to more information on it, see Pastor Keith.
I can't let this go.
That says less days, more money.
instead of a 2-week trip, we're trying to make it an 8-day trip. And it will be less money, too. Last year, when we tried to do this, some feedback came back that it was a little bit too long for a lot of schedules and a little bit too much. So we pared it down, but we're including Petra. And I'm sorry to have interrupted your short
important clarification there. The ladies are going to sell soup next week. It'll be a drive-through deal. They'll have it out in the parking lot. So if you'd like to get some of the church lady soup. And the last announcement, and this is the big one, we're saving the big one for last. We're going to start the children's program next week. Thank you. Elma and Mary are spearheading out. We're going to do a one-room schoolhouse type of thing. And this is how this is going to work. You come around to the west entrance, the lower entrance. You drop your kids off before the service. They're going to go right into the multi-purpose room. They'll be in there during the whole service. After the service, you drive back around. You pick your kids up. The kids will never be in the stairwells. They won't be mixing with the adults. So it's going to be extremely safe. And for those of you that have not been able to come back to church, we're going to have something for the kids. We're going to start that off. We're going to get a hold of the middle school kids, and we're going to start that again in the next couple of weeks. We'll be doing that. So there's a lot going on, a lot of announcements. Pastor Pete.
Thank you, Jim. Appreciate it. Just a couple things. 2 minutes before we started our transmission this morning, there was a hiccup in the technical side of the program. And we're going back to the iPad method. So for those of you who are at home, if you see a little difference in transmission or quality, we're transmitting this week from an iPad rather than our camera system. Aren't the leaves magnificent? The panorama of colors? I envy anybody who gets to travel through Pennsylvania or New England during these weeks. And our decorations have taken on a fall tone as well. And we welcome you during this fall season. When I think about my Christian life, and we think about our lives as Christians, the main word is Christ. Christ-centered, Christ-led, and about Christ. And our best role model for how to live in this world is the life of Christ. And it's not unusual to want to say, what would Jesus do in a situation like this? And I want to focus our thoughts today a little bit about what would Jesus do? How would Jesus do it? And not only that, but I think about World Communion Sunday, which is today. I think about these words that Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount in chapter 5 of Matthew. Therefore, if you are offering a gift at the altar, and you remember that there's a rift with you, a brother or a sister, there's something against you, leave your gift at the altar. Go first to be reconciled, then come and offer your gift. We see as we remember that Christians around the world, from shore to shore, continent to continent, we're going to celebrate today what unites us. But we're also going to celebrate the unity that binds us together. I appreciate your prelude. Bind us together, Lord. Bind us together. What would Jesus do in the context of a week like we have had here in America?
What would Jesus do? Will you bow your heads with me for today's invocation? Dear God, as we gather and worship on this World Communion Sunday, we ask that you send your Holy Spirit to fall afresh on us. God, we pray for your Spirit to awaken new hope and new life in us. Grant us the vision to see the coming of your kingdom. Help us to celebrate the glimpses of grace that you have given to each of us. And God, we pray to knit our hearts together in worship and communion, particularly this morning. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. you all may be seated. You may be seated. Thank you, praise team. A great job today. High and lifted up. If you want to read the text that tells us about that, I guess I should take this off, is Revelation 4, but particularly Revelation chapter 5, is the biblical account of the song that we just talked about, just sang about Jesus, our Redeemer, the Lamb that was slain. And all of heaven breaks loose with the realization that there is hope, there is possibility. We don't have to live in the mire of this world, but we can be lifted up. As the name of Jesus is lifted up, so are we lifted up like wings, like eagles. Friends, we want to thank you for so many things. But we want to thank you for your giving. Each week we thank God for the resources that have allowed the ministries of the church to continue. And while we've pared a lot of things back, it seems like what we're focused on is taking on more focus, more attention, and more effectiveness. We're being a lot more strategic with the resources that we have, and as they've been tightened up, we think that God is multiplying in a huge way. So we thank you for your giving, thank you for your faithfulness in those kind of ways. Yesterday, the Methodist Church of Western Pennsylvania had an annual conference. Typically we do it in June, typically we do it at Grove City College for 3 or 4 days. It was rescheduled to be at the Erie Bayfront Convention Center, but also due to COVID, that was canceled. And we had a virtual conference yesterday. What a different world we're living in. But the bishop delivered an outstanding and encouraging message. And I want you to know that not only in South Harbor Creek, but around the conference, God's people are doing the work of ministry in maybe more effective ways than we were even a year ago. Different, but more effective. Matter of fact, right here in Harbor Creek, South Harbor Creek Church is along with Faith Redeemer, with Our Lady of Mercy, with Harbor Creek Presbyterian Church, and others, helping provide meals that children can take home that are challenged or underprivileged at Clark School. And that program is looking to expand into Klein School and Roman Ridge as well. And that's just one of many ministries that are getting traction as we go into the fall this year. We want to be praying for those in our church that aren't feeling well. Last week, we prayed heartfelt prayers, not knowing exactly the situation. Carol Ford, who is in intensive care. She's recuperating. She's in a step-down room, going to a normal room, and expects to be home in a number of days. Thank you, God. Butch Gregory, intensive care with pneumonia. I saw him, and he was released directly. He's now at his son's house. We continue to pray for Butch as his lungs and breathing strengthen, even in the midst of his other disease. But the pneumonia is passing. John Tinsley. He was unconscious on a ventilator last Sunday in intensive care. I didn't know if I would see him otherwise. I talked to him yesterday. He gave me a fist pump. He was getting ready to watch a college football game, and he'll be released and returning to Sarah Reed. If not yesterday, then today. Then I got a call. We got word that I talked to Leona Thompson. She was taken to the emergency room yesterday. She has a blood clot. She would like her church family will be praying for her as she is now in care at the hospital. There are many others as well, but these are some of the names that we've been praying for. And of course, we need to pray not only thanks and for blessing, but we need to pray for our country. Will you bow your heads as I lead us in a pastoral prayer? We'll conclude with the Lord's Prayer in just a few moments. Heavenly Father, you are high and lifted. We sing a song like that, I think about being in the heavenly throne room, and I can't even imagine. I get tears and I am overwhelmed with the glory and the wonder that's to come. But Lord, your kingdom is taking root in our lives and our hearts right now. We're being made like new creations from the inside out if we allow the Holy Spirit to have your way with us. God, we thank you for your care about little old planet Earth. For each of 7 billion people around the earth. You know the hairs on our head. You know our goings and your comings. every and each one of us. And God, always your voice is calling us back to you. May we respond. God, we pray for those that have been ill. We pray for those we're not aware of that aren't doing as well physically as we'd like them to be. And we pray your blessing upon them. One name I forgot was Jean Ekstrand. She was taken to the hospital this week. And again, hoping to be released today or tomorrow, if not already. God, we pray for Leona Thompson. We pray for John Tinsley and Butch Gregory and Carol Ford. We thank you for your faithfulness. We know that we all have a season to be. But we want to be as vital and alive, and we want to be ambassadors for Jesus as long as we can. Surround these lives as they renew and refresh their strength and as you minister to them and their families. God, what a week for our country. And I share now a prayer that I wrote and posted on Facebook on Friday. Dear God, we pray for our country. In so many ways, your word instructs us, commands us, and we pray. Commands us to pray for our country and its leaders. With hearts of obedience and genuine concern, we pray for our president and his wife and those in their inner circles, for healing, for protection and well-being. God, we trust your Holy Spirit to intercede in all these and related concerns. We pray for safety to those that are otherwise moving in these kind of circles. We pray for Congress, both the House and the Senate. We pray for the people who are going to be benefiting, we pray, from relief packages that are approved. We pray for our leaders that they will exercise judgments and discernments and spirits that would reflect Jesus the Christ. Not for Democrats or Republicans, but we pray for each as they vote, as they live their lives. For the well-being and health of those who are sick with COVID, and those who surround them with love and care and concern. And God, I pray that we might live as your children, in Jesus' name. And now, in congregation, would you join me to pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Before we stand to sing the hymn, One Body, One Bread, anticipating the time of communion with God, with one another, I will ask you to stand to recite the Apostles' Creed, which unites Christians from around the world in common faith, and then remain standing as we join together in the hymn that's to come. Will you please stand with me as we recite the Apostles' Creed? We believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again to judge the living. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Will you remain standing as Sue and Linda lead us in today's hymn, One Body, One Bread.
church to sing old songs. That song came to prominence in the 1960s, and it was written by a Jesuit priest, and we're grateful for the song that reminds us that we gather together in one body. Helping us when Sue was gone was Stephanie Kraft. Stephanie, you are showing up all over the church. You do all kinds of things in the church. Your job description is longer than mine. It's got all kinds of... Stephanie's always filling in. I think that, Linda, you had a hiccup the other day, and she called 1-800-STEPHANIE. All Stephanie. But in thinking about Stephanie and acknowledging her as well as so many others that are working so very hard during this time, I was reminded of your dad, Paul. And we should have listed him with the others. But Paul has been in a long-term care facility, and due to the requirements of that particular facility, has had virtually no face-to-face touch with his family since March. Calls, but it gets to be a lot. And we need to be praying for him, not only in body, but in spirit. And he will be encouraged that he realizes he's a child of God, that he has a ministry given there in the care facility. Pray particularly for Paul. So as I pray for today's message, I'm also going to add Paul to that list. Heavenly Father, we do lift Paul up to you. I would pray that people will find ways to reach out and encourage the Kraft family and might convey messages to Paul that would encourage him. And God, we pray for your blessing upon the word today. It may not be my words, but your words inspired for this congregation that's both here and in our virtual community. In Jesus' name. Do you like these people?
united with Christ, reconciled one to the other, celebrating one with God and one with the other. We've already looked at the words of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount, where he says and describes that if you come to the altar with a gift for the Lord, that it will be made righteous if we are reconciled with all of those in our lives that we might be discordant or out of step with. God calls us to be reconciled. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 is all about reconciliation, where we are made new creations, but we must be reconciled, and we must be ambassadors. So not only should we be reconciled, but we need to be ambassadors of reconciliation, agents of peace, not contentiousness. We need to be people that bring peace and harmony, that are healers. Now, what I'd like to do is read to you from 1 Corinthians, our primary text for today. The Corinthian church was on the lower part of the Greek peninsula. A big church, but a dysfunctional church. Boy, they did have problems. But this particular week, in 1 Corinthians 11, Paul is writing to them about one of the more significant problems in Paul's teaching. Let me read to you from 1 Corinthians 11, 17 to 22. In the following, says Paul, I have no praise for you. You don't hear pastors say that very often. And here's Paul telling the Corinthians, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. You're better off not even meeting for what's happening. In the first place, I hear that when we come together as a church in the first century, that there are divisions among you, that you don't even get together in the same room, that you hardly talk to each other, that there's animosity and bad feelings. And I believe it, he says, based on what I heard. No doubt there's differences among you, but you have God's approval. So then, when you come together, it is not the Lord's supper that you eat. For when you are eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. You're extravagant. You have shrimp cocktail, filet mignon, and you eat in extravagance. You eat to be full, not to revere and worship God. Because you are fluent and able, you get together at 4:30 in the afternoon and start your festivities. Meanwhile, those who are working all day long, I'm paraphrasing, obviously, I hope you know that. Those of you who are working all day long come together at 6:30 and 7 with barely enough provision to bring a little bread and a little juice or a little wine to remember the reverence of what Jesus did on the cross 10, 15 years before that. He writes in verse 22, don't you have homes to eat in, those of you who are eating these big meals? Don't be offensive. Don't rub their nose in it. Don't eat before them. Eat together. Friday night, our son Sam had friends over. Sam's got an apartment at the house. Boy, he cooked a dinner for him. It was awesome. It was like a dinner party. And you know what? Sam and his friends did not offer Linda and I one single bite. It was like torture. The aromas were coming up the staircase. Oh, I'm hungry. Imagine that in a setting of communion in the first century. In the homes of the era, church groups and house groups would gather. The aroma of the food and the feast in one part of the house would trickle to the other part of the house, and those with the most meager of provisions, having trouble even making ends meet, could hardly focus on the communion with Jesus, the body, the blood of Christ, for the festivities and the laughter and the aromas of a feast happening in another part of the house. Paul says, what should I say to you? Shall I give you praise? Certainly not. No matter, it is not to be praised. Wow. As I read it, I explained. was happening. It was a segregated church, rich and poor, Gentile and Jew. It was not united. It was divided. And I ask you, what do you think Jesus would do had Jesus been there? Well, Jesus gave the church the voice of Paul, the apostle, who in the form of a letter is telling the church how they should behave. Let me take a break for just a moment from this story of the Corinthian church. As many of you know, I like history and I like books. I've got on my shelf a book that Linda got for me called In His Steps. This book is dated 1898. It's a second edition. The first edition was 1896. It was written by Charles Sheldon. Charles Sheldon was a minister in America in that day. This book is a classic. Since the turn of the century, more than 50 million copies of this book have been sold. It's a Christian classic that I suspect most have not heard about. I bought a contemporary version this week on Amazon for $5.99. In His Step. It's still in print, it's still on the bestseller list. It's a great book. We need to credit Charles Sheldon with a movement that happened across America a few years ago called WWJD. Do you remember that? WWJD, what would Jesus do? Charles Sheldon tells this story. The main character is a man named Reverend Henry Maxwell. It happens primarily in the town of Reynolds, the town of Raymond. All we know about Raymond is it's a railroad town, somewhere between Chicago and Maine, probably closer to Maine. We pick up with this town, and we pick up with a character named Jack Manning. Jack appears to be a bum, a tramp. And in the beginning of the book, Charles Sheldon has Jack Manning showing up in different parts of town, generally being shunned. Even when he went to the school, he was shunned as a tramp, as a no good. Reverend Henry Maxwell was working on his sermon, and the doorbell rings. He looks down and sees a tramp standing at the door. He goes down and is generally dismissive to Jack Manning and sends Jack on his way so that he could finish his sermon that Friday. Now we go forward to Sunday morning. Jack Manning, the tramp, silently slips into the back of the church. Near the end of the service, Jack Manning, the tramp, shuffles right up to the front of the chancel. Begins to speak. No one stops him. They're all dumbfounded that this tramp, this lowlife, would be making any appearance, let alone to speak. He says in a quiet voice, "But the community is not reflecting the love of God." He confronts the church, confronts the pastor. He said, "Now, I'm not complaining, mind you. I'm just stating the facts. I'm not complaining. I'm just stating the facts. In regards to their lack of compassion and apathy to the plight of the homeless throughout America at that time, but particularly in that town, to those that are less fortunate. Everyone's mouth dropped open. Nobody knows what to do. And you know what happens? Jack Manning drops to the ground and falls over. And 3 days later, he dies. This haunts that church. Imagine being confronted by a homeless tramp and having collapse in front of you. Henry Maxwell, the pastor, is particularly haunted. And with inspiration, begins to preach a series of stories
that would encourage his church. But bottom line, he tells them, let us not do anything without asking ourselves first, what would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? The rest of the novel is a number of chapters and episodes about different characters in the city that begin to embrace. There was a newspaper man who all of a sudden realized that he was giving more print and headlines to the atrocities of life, to the seamy side of life. He even refused and decided not to cover a boxing match, which was considered among the seemlier things in that day. His newspaper said, but you'll lose advertising. He says, but I can't do that. We're called to a higher ethic as a Christian. One of the workers in the church worked for the railroad became aware of some fraudulent activity, was so convicted and so unable to work in that environment, quit his job at the railroad. Who ever heard of quitting the job at the railroad? That'd be like quitting the job at GE or WebTech in today's world. And the story is unfold in this book. All the way to Chicago, we see the effect of blessing and strength and encouragement. From Maine to Chicago, it's a wonderful story. I would encourage you to read it. It's called In His Steps. But the standard is, what would Jesus do? That's not a bad way to ask. What would Jesus do? Paul did the same thing in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Let me pick up with the rest of the text, beginning in verse 23. Paul reminds the Corinthian church how communion was started. Not how they were celebrating it, but how communion was started. And Paul writes, the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave thanks. He broke the bread and said, this is my body, which symbolically is being broken for you. And as I'm being broken, I want you to remember that we must be broken before we can remain whole. And that in my brokenness, I open the door to eternal life and new spirit in you. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, this is the cup of the new covenant, the covenant that will be commemorated with the resurrection of Easter Sunday. My blood will be poured out for you, but drink this in remembrance of my lifeblood being poured out that there might be new life and a new covenant. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death. So, like Henry Maxwell, the minister, Paul reminds his church of the standard that we are called to do. Paul reminds them of the first communion meal. Henry Maxwell reminds them that we are, as Christians, called to live like Christ. One God, one with each other, together united for the sake of witness, that we are to bring the kingdom of God here on earth, not just for our well-being, but for the well-being of those that we live with. A wonderful, joyous, and reverent celebration should be reminded as we do communion. He then goes on and finishes his writing, chapter 11. So then, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood. Paul sets forth the doctrine that if we take communion without the right spirit, without a spirit of unity, of care, of concern, without regard, that we will be guilty of sinning, of breaking relationships instead of uniting relationships. Everyone ought to examine, Paul writes, before they eat the bread and drink the cup. In a few minutes, we'll be celebrating communion for the first time since before March. And part of the great Thanksgiving that we celebrate when we thank God for the wonder of communion is we confess our sin, that we might be one with God and one with each other. Paul says that. Therefore, when you gather together, discern
with care one for the other. Nevertheless, when we are judged in the way of the Lord, we are disciplined so that we will not be condemned to the world. Friends, communion is a celebration. Where there was no life, there is now life. Life in the Spirit. The kingdom of God growing in us, that the kingdom of God might grow without us. It's something joyous, but it's reverent, it's sacred, it's to be regarded, not to be taken lightly. And I think too often our churches today will take communion lightly. So as we begin to prepare ourselves for communion, examine yourselves. Confess. God, I don't live as well as I should. I know that. But before I take this communion, I want this to be a special moment, a reverent moment. And I pray that I might be reconciled with you and reconciled with one another. That we might, around the world, join together as a Christian community, standing in contrast to the world which seems so divided, so bitter, so angry, so insecure, so afraid. But that's not the Christian way. But we are to be lifted up with wings like eagles. The love of God that is in you is greater than he that is in the world. What does this mean to you and I in South Hartford Church? It means we are one body, body of Christ. We begin spiritual life. And I think revival is coming to this church. I think revival is coming to the Christian church as it's purged of the fringes. The core will unite together in these months of trial and challenge. Why? That the world might know the wonder of his love. Not Republicans and Democrats. As best as you're able, I forbid you to look at one another as a Republican or as a Democrat, but rather see one another as Jesus sees you, as a child of God. Those political conversations can happen outside the walls of this church. But when they're happening, do it in the name of fellowship, united in Christ. Our lives and our actions will reveal our ultimate loyalty. To who are you ultimately loyal? To whom are you ultimately identified? Can you and do you join with those on your left and on your right? In this wondrous celebration of communion, which we have not celebrated for such a long time. The praise team will come, and we're going to sing a song as we prepare our hearts, called "They Will Know That We Are Christians by Our Love." And as we sing this song, think about the joy and the wonder of Christian unity. And if in a fictional book, the people in Raymond can change the world if they did what Jesus did. Let us live as Jesus lived. Let us celebrate and thank God for the life that we have, the life we will have, the life that's been there. For those that are going, let me just share a word of instruction. After the song, we're going to undergo the communion. By church direction, the Methodists don't believe that we can serve communion in a virtual way. So those that are here will share with us the communion. For those of you who are watching, we are permitted and encouraged to do something called a love feast. It's a symbolic replica. Now, I've done love feasts with potato chips and Coke. So for those of you who are at home, I encourage you, if you'd like, to take a Cheerio and a glass of milk, or a sip of coffee. But in your mind, be reflecting on what we're celebrating here at the Great Sacrament. Time of confession, a time of unity, and a time of celebration. Will you stand and join with us as we sing? They will know that we are Christians by our love.
We pray.
rather than passing the trays and the elements that are coming forward for attention. For those that are in person here, we have these little plastic cups. There's a wafer at the top and a cup, and I'm sure you've been told, but you need to almost flick the top layer so that you get to the wafer first. When I first saw these, I ripped off the whole thing. I couldn't get to the wafer. I was chewing and gnawing at my teeth. I finally got a scissors to get the wafer. But if you do it right, you just flip it up. You can have the wafer like that, and you break it for the cup. Christ our Lord unites us at his table. For all who love him are welcomed and encouraged. For those who seek him are invited to come. This is not a Methodist table, but an open table. Seems fitting for real communion. All those who repent of their sins and lives and seek to have peace with God are welcome. Part of having peace with God is a confession of those things we've done that separate us from the love of God and the love of one another. Will those that are here share with me in the prayer of confession? This prayer is available online with the order of worship. Join with me. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all this. Grant that we might serve you in newness of life and glory. And as a minister of the gospel, Almighty God, who forgives sins of all those who truly repent, I declare in the name of God, not my name, but the name of God Almighty, that your sins are forgiven indeed. And we recall, as Paul did with the people in the Corinthian church, Jesus says, take, break the bread. It is like the body of Christ being broken for you. He holds the cup up. Jesus says, when it's time, drink. This is my life being poured out to you, that life might be made new. With the bread and with the cup, I pray. Holy Spirit, descend upon us gathered here. These gifts of bread and juice, make your presence for us today as the body and the blood of Christ. We might be to the world the body of Christ, the ambassador of reconciliation, redeemed by the sacrifice of Jesus our Lord. And for those that are here, I ask you to take the top layer off and the wafer that represents the element. Take and eat. This is my body. It was broken that we might be united. As you're able to take the top off, I ask you then to drink from the cup. Ooh, I like that. That's good. You all can't do this, but I'm going to have some of the real bread. Communion is to be celebrated, not in a way that divides, but in a way that unites. I'm going to say benediction. The praise team will play some music as the people that are here exit. We want to thank you, whether you're online or here, for having joined us today. For those that are here, another one of Stephanie's jobs is to help dismiss people in an orderly way that we can maintain distancing because we like each other. We don't want to make each other sick. So follow Stephanie's directions. God, we read last week about Aaron's blessing. We pray that you will bless this congregation, near and far. We pray that you will bless your church around the world. We pray that your face will shine upon the face of your people. And that indeed we might have a distinctive life that encourages and shares and gives testimony to the unity that is so unique, but should be a mark of Christians around the world. Draw us together. May this be the best week of the rest of our lives. And God, I pray blessing upon your people and your kingdom come. In Jesus' name.